So thanks for coming, folks. We might as well kick off because we've got loads to get through. So Ed is going to talk about Tralee Bay and his Seagrass project. Craig Ferguson is going to do a presentation on his work. And then Alex is going to talk to us about the work up in Carringford and seagrass meadows in Greece. And then Ed has a short video about the nature restoration laws from the Irish Wildlife Trust. And then after that, I'll turn the recording off. And if we want to, we can do a bit of a Q&A and we can talk about seagrass habitat and things like that. So, Ed, do you want to kick us off?
Yeah, thanks very much, Rory. Really appreciate it. It's a pleasure to talk about seagrass. I've only gotten into it really recently, so unlike folks like Pandra, my time is pretty much this has been a COVID project for me. I got to start looking at the marine environment in 2021, and we were actually trying to save a local sand dune, but somebody told us that this sand dune was affected by the amount of seagrass that you might find around on either side of it. So I went looking for seagrass and started mapping it. In 2021, we did quite a bit of mapping. And then we started doing in 2022 studies with the Smithsonian Marine Global Earth Observatory. And they're a global network where there's typically larger research institutes that do really high quality kind of measurements. But for me, I was just kind of beginner. So I started off by doing some half decent mapping of seagrass beds. I started looking at the flowering, the morphology of seagrass, which I thought was fascinating. Started using a few measurements. But at the bottom of it, I mean, mostly what I like to do is be out and my SUP and kayaks and snorkeling and eventually diving for the joy of being in the water. So we've got a very small conservation group here. We started off using some open source software. Google Earth Pro was my tool. This is 2022 seagrass map. This is the seagrass in the bright green with where that last where the video of the 14 stingrays was up here. And this is all kind of surrounding Fenit Island. So the seagrass, kind of from our perspective, is what our local brent geese population eat all the time. So we see this really significant change in how much seagrass we have here in Barrow Harbor. We find that this is subtidal, where this is intertidal. And this seagrass is fairly stable, with the exception of some underwater scouring that took place. And the difference between 2021 and 2022 was that about 23 centimeters was just ground off of this end of the southern end of the seagrass bed. And we got to watch it regrow, and we got to see the transitions of species. And like, even though it kind of looks in this picture, when you're looking at this, that there might be seagrass here as well, this is typically a cordophyllum or a mermaid stresses is what the local name of it is here. So our seagrass bed is surrounded by a lot of seaweed, and it's a habitat-forming species, which means that it has a tendency to, when it starts to grow, it changes the environment. And the way that it does that is it just causes sand to fall out of the water. And it does that because water is slowing down, the current's slowing down as it's going through the dense seagrass meadows. So sand is deposited, the roots grow deeper and deeper, kind of like the opposite of peat. Well, it's like peat except underwater. And so that's kind of where I started off. Whoops. I was actually describing something you guys weren't looking at. My apologies. This is the seagrass map that I was referring to, Barrow Harbor off the coast, common stingrays. And this is what we ended up finding was that a lot of beds were very similar between the years. And except for this one where the brent geese just ate it solid over the winter. In 2023, we were lucky to get another small grant. It was a 1,000 euro grant from the National Aquarium. We had four coastal communities working together. And even though this is a subtitled seagrass bed, you can walk up to it every day. And the reason for that is it's on a rocky outcrop, and the rock catches the water as the tide goes out. But there's always water in here. And everybody, I mean, could safely approach anytime they wanted to go out and take a look at it. And all we ask them to do is to measure once a month a 5 by 5 centimeter square and find every species that they could in that one square. So that was their goal. And we just have it. I thought we had a brilliant time doing it. We identified a lot of new species. We got to see the way that, you know, you go from the rocky to the, I mean, it was a limestone seafloor bed. But right there, you can see that this is about 7 centimeters of sand, and it's held together by all of the roots, all the rhizomes that are coming out of the seagrass, which are these little green dyes here. And it was just good fun. People fell in love with sea hares, and we got to actually record a lot of interesting data about the flowering and when it took place. And that's going to be helpful to us if we ever do restoration around Tralee Bay, which is very likely. And finally, I just like to say thanks to so many people. Sea Search for teaching us how to identify things, going to their courses was brilliant. Working with guys like Tim Butter from the Cork Aqua Club and his efforts to get new folks into the water, I think is absolutely essential. And it's something I'm really trying to work on down here in Tralee Bay and in Kerry in general, is to get more people to put their heads under the water. So that's one of my goals. Marine Biodiversity Citizen Science course I also thought was brilliant, because when you couldn't talk to folks, and sometimes it's really hard to get them to learn it, but I found that their course was really good for getting folks started. And then the other thing I found that once we started making observations was that iNaturalist is absolutely brilliant in terms of helping people to develop their ability to identify a species correctly and down to the species level. I found it pretty harsh at first. Some of the times people would be very critical or kind of be flippant about your bad observations. Very quickly, they help you understand if you ask them, you know, how to do it. And we found it a really good mechanism for sharing our expertise as we developed between our groups. So listen, that's an overview of what we do. There's a lot of other things that I'd love to talk about, but I'd like to also keep on schedule. So Craig, could I turn it over to you at this point? And would you mind telling us about what is seagrass and why is it so important?
Perfect. Hello, everyone. My name is Craig. I'm just going to pop this screen up here quickly. I also hope you can see that. Move this out of the way. Right, so my name is Craig Ferguson. I am from Galway. I'm actually from Mayo, but I'm living in Galway at the moment. I studied marine science here in the University of Galway, and my final year project mainly involved mapping seagrass. So it was mapping Zostera marina beds in Kilcurran Bay. I had quite a novel approach. I used an ROV, some remote sensing data, and machine learning algorithms to try and streamline and make a methodology that was quick for mapping seagrass. And so if you have like a short amount of time and a method that involves the least amount of people as possible, so cost effective was also where I was looking into doing that. So to do that, I got a mini ROV. I 3D printed mounts for it. So I connected a camera and a GoPro and a big light underneath it. And that was tethered then to a top end transceiver that I would use from a boat. So we'd send the ROV down and we would work up on the boat, surveying different areas of the seagrass bed in Kilcurran Bay. I already had a pre-selected area that was surveyed quite extensively before by the National Parks and Wildlife Services and a few other organizations to try and to have some sort of ground truth for my data. But essentially, I have a short video that will go through the presentation of that. It explains a bit about why seagrasses are important ecosystems. So I'm just going to share that now. Hopefully the audio works.
Hi, my name is Greg Ferguson, and this presentation is on my final year project, Assessing Zostera Marina Distribution and Associated Macrobenthic Community Structure in Kilcurran Bay, a novel approach using an ROV, remote sensing, and machine learning. So firstly, what is my project all about? The study presents an assessment of the distribution and cover of Zostera Marina, commonly known as eelgrass, along with its associated community structure at varying depths in Kilcurran Bay, using a modified mini ROV and LiDAR-derived remote sensing data. Understanding the distribution of and the communities associated with eelgrass using relatively low-cost and easily deployable equipment is important for marine spatial planning, conservation efforts, and water quality assessments. But why? Well, here's some background to the matter. In order to understand the importance of seagrass in the outlined context, one must understand why seagrass is important. Seagrasses form the basis to many ecosystems, providing food and shelter for marine life, including endangered species. Seagrasses are economically important to nursery grounds for commercial fish species and are an attraction for ecotourism. They improve water quality by filtering pollutants and sediments, and they also reduce coastal erosion. Zostera Marina has shown to reduce cliff erosion by up to 70%. Seagrasses absorb approximately 10% of global carbon emissions annually, despite covering only 0.2% of the ocean. Along with the ecological value of removing carbon from the environment, economically, these carbon stores are incredibly valuable in the context of regional climate change adaptation strategies. Considering the importance of these ecosystems, mapping their distributions is imperative. However, current knowledge on their global distribution is not satisfactory. Seagrasses are found globally, with an estimated coverage between 160,387 and 266,562 kilometers squared, and have been classified into six bioregions. It's estimated that we lose approximately 0.4% to 16% of these ecosystems annually. Climate change impacts such as rising sea levels, warming temperatures, and storm damages are all threats to these meadows. Currently, there are 42 countries that have no seagrass records and 67 that lack polygon data. Rapid, cost-effective methodologies must be developed in order to routinely monitor the extent of seagrass meadows and their change. So, what's the deal with seagrass in Ireland? In Ireland, Zostera Marina is the most common seagrass. It is commonly referred to as eelgrass in English and mílchcnoch in Irish, and it is most abundant along the west and southwest coasts. Under Annex 5 of the Water Framework Directive, Zostera Marina has been selected as a biological quality element, and as part of its monitoring, one must examine the abundance of seagrass and the taxonomic composition of the habitat that it provides. These meadows are protected under the European Union Habitats Directive, the Berne Convention based on the UNIS Habitats Classification, and the Oslo-Paris Conventions. In order to understand more about the distributions of seagrass, my project employed a new methodology for mapping seagrass in a safe, cost-effective manner. Utilizing both consumer-grade mini ROVs and remote sensing technologies appeared to be an applicable approach, as collectively, these allow for a non-invasive, cost-effective, safe method for large-scale mapping and ground truthing of seagrass's spatial extent and associated taxa, ultimately meeting the survey requirements of the Water Framework Directive. Additionally, the use of machine learning algorithms was identified as a potentially useful incorporation. The significance of this project is to emphasize the ecological role of Zostera Marina as ecosystem engineers and their importance under the Habitats Directive. Additionally, the project aims to provide a foundational review of these technologies' efficacy for cost-effective, safe, and accurate data collection pertaining to the monitoring of Zostera Marina meadows as a biological quality element under Annex 5 of the Water Framework Directive. In order to show this significance, the following hypotheses were devised. The modified mini ROV can effectively record Zostera Marina distribution. Zostera Marina abundance varies with depth. Greater Zostera cover leads to higher species richness, and species richness and macrobenthic community structure are influenced by Zostera presence and depth. The survey site that was selected was a Zostera-dominated community complex in Chiron Fia, Kilcurran Bay, County Galway. This meadow was selected as it had already been well documented within previous studies and reports. A Trident Open ROV was used to survey the community. The ROV was controlled remotely from a handheld controller, which received the live video feed from a topside transceiver. This transceiver was tethered to the ROV and shared data between it and the controller. In order to get a top-down viewing angle for observing the macrobenthic community structure amongst the Z Marina blades, two 3D printed mounts were attached to the ROV. These equipped the ROV with a GoPro Hero 11 Black and an 84 LED panel. In order to provide geospatial data to each sampled video frame, a GPS was fastened to a topside buoy that was tethered to the ROV via the data cable. Six shore-based transects and six boat-based transects were conducted over 2 days. The shore-based transects used 80-meter lines that extended perpendicularly from the shoreline at Chiron Fia. As the ROV is limited by the length of its tether, the boat-based transects allowed the ROV to survey areas over 100 meters offshore. Once the surveys were conducted, an equation was created in order to correspond to the recorded location intervals with their associated video frames. These identified frames were then input to code written for FFmpeg, a video and image analysis console, in order to export the frames from the video. A rudimentary test was devised to define scale in each image. This was done by measuring the change in pixels to 50 centimeters.
Could I ask if maybe we're getting into too much depth here, and could we stop it at this point?
Sure thing.
It's just too deep, perhaps, for divers at this point to look at some of these
statistics. No problem.
Yeah.
Cool.
Thanks.
So I have two more slides then continuing on from that. So ultimately the project showed that seagrass does make a significant difference of splitting up communities. Each symbol here represents a different community structure where you have different assemblage of species, and based on how they're separated depends on how similar they are to each other. And the symbols just basically it basically means that these groups are ones that have more seagrass together. These ones have not as much seagrass, and then there's less seagrass, so they spread out differently based on the seagrass that's there. You can also see here from some of the data that's on the map, the bathymetry, the way that the seagrass actually structures the meadow, or the seabed, I should say. As the sediments are coming in, they're getting caught in the seagrass blades, and that settles and lands onto the seabed. That helps build up against coastal erosion. It decreases tidal influences. So any waves that come in, they're all being slowed down against the shoreline. And then that's also has the double effect of creating habitat for a number of species. So continuing on. Yeah, and then here's some characteristic species that I found during my survey. There was all types of seaweeds. Sargassum, Uticum, Fucus serratus, all the different brown seaweeds, and then a lot of anemones. They were quite easy to identify. One thing that I would comment on from what I was doing for my survey is the fact that I was using a top-down video camera to record all the stuff. Anything that was hidden amongst any vegetation, whether it be kelp frond or the seagrass blades themselves, they're a lot harder to identify. So the data would have, there's quite a few errors still in that method of data collection. You can see here is one of the screenshots from Beagle where species were identified. It's not as easy to pick out each one in particular. So other recommendations for that would be to do eDNA barcoding and also manual sampling in certain areas to help build up the data. But that's just a quick overview pretty much of the research that I was doing on seagrass and a bit of information as to why seagrasses are important. So I hope you enjoyed.
Oh, that's brilliant. It's an amazing project that you did, and I think you're going to have a great future. Certainly in the field that you pick there. I think to compare what Craig has done, it's worth taking a look at some of the things that have been done by some of the sea search groups. And one of the sea search groups that's done the most, I think, is Finn Butter's group with the Cork Aqua Club. And they work down in Oyster Haven. So excuse me, I just can't get to my move on. This is a youth program that he kicked off in 2021 to get more divers involved, in fact, more people in general involved. In his first year, he taught the basic skills of snorkeling and took them through the program to become competent divers. Following that, the approach that he took was that he went to, in 2022, he got a couple of very interesting grants. I just got to move this out of the way. Go away. The overview that he printed out at the end of it was, this paper, which I thought was really nicely done. And one of the characteristics that we found, at least, him and ourselves both agreed on this, is we found a lot of interesting worms in the sand in the seagrass beds. So the approach that he took is he got an idea of the extent, which is what you see in the map there. It's got the red line around where the patchy seagrass is, and you can kind of look through the polygon, the green part, to see the splotchiness of it. And he has a really good list of species that he found within the seagrass. So to take a look at Tim's reports, and this is Tim here on the right and to the Aqua Group. They have really good gear, they have really good training, their safety is excellent. Highly recommend that you look at his papers. He also took advantage of getting a National Park and Wildlife Service grant, which is something that's available to all of us. I got one in 2022, and it certainly helped me to get started in a big way. The typical format that he uses is, you know, the introduction, some of the methodology. But the thing that we all really appreciate most, even more than the mapping, is what kind of critters you see. And, you know, the Scotch jellyfish, and some of it, this is a fairly rare anemone that he picked up. The worms, with the spider crab, Rory? Oh, yeah, sorry, long-legged spider crab, yep. You know, the nudibranch. And to put out a fairly good list of what you've seen is what we've all done, I think, in all of our papers. So coming up with a format like that is the typical submission that they look for national parks and wildlife. And he did it twice. I guess he did a second paper on the same thing. I'll just show you his final extent map. I'm not going to get it. This is just annoying. Okay, my apologies for not being able to do that. They're probably open here somewhere. There they are. So he's mapped a couple of other seagrass beds that he's seen, but it gives you a rough indication and a rough idea of how many, you know, thousands of square meters he's starting to map at this point. So they've been very, very good at getting larger and larger areas mapped and identified. Okay. There's another group that I wanted to mention, and that's the Cornwall group. Don't know if you guys have heard about these guys. They have these search affiliation. I've got to figure out how to get turned off. Any help, Rory? Can you actually, I think this turns off my entire screen sharing, if I'm not mistaken.
Sorry, I'm muted. Yeah, if you just turn off the screen share and just open up the thing that you want and come back, it'll probably be the easiest way to do.
Yeah, not a bad idea. I've just got too much open, don't I? Well, actually, this is turning everything off. That's great. Apologies, everybody. Okay, so here's the Cornwall folk. And let me just get rid of everything else so that I won't have that happen again. So this is Cornwall. They're a group, obviously, southwest of the UK. They have about 18 groups, I believe, in their entire group. All right, so this is the Yorkshire Network. This is the list of the sites that they have in Cornwall. And I think they've got a really interesting way of getting people into the water that I'd like to know more about. I think this guy's name is Matt, if I'm not mistaken. Ring a bell to you, Rory? Might have.
No, I don't think I know anyone from the Cornwall Seagrass
group. Okay. I think these are his details. Here we go. Yeah, Matt Slater. So he's Wildlife Trust and also Sea Search Cornwall Regional Coordinator. So they've got an interesting way of getting snorkelers involved. And one of the things I guess I'd say to us as a community is getting folks, you know, including myself, diving more. Starting off in a seagrass bed is not a bad place to start because you're in fairly shallow water. You know, here around Tralee Bay, it's never more than about 5 meters deep, hardly a dive from you guys' perspective. But there's a lot to learn in that space. And you can snorkel it as well. You know, I only needed to do the diving, in fairness, to learn to take a few better pictures, you know, and to be able to sit there and quietly observe things like, you know, the little cuttlefish. And to do the Smithsonian protocol, you kind of were stationary counting tubes and, you know, taking close-ups of the epiphytes and stuff underwater. But I thought their approach was kind of nice. And another one, I think I've already mentioned, Dave Walls, National Biodiversity Data Center. And then our Angus Jackson, he's our data officer with Sea Search. He's also been involved with seagrass surveys. And I think he's talking to us sometime in April, isn't he, Rory?
Yeah.
I think Tony's trying to set that up.
Yeah, we still don't have a date for that talk.
Yeah, and this is fairly typical of what we're looking. You know, we get heavy epiphyte growth, brown algae. Sometimes you get bryozoas growing. We've seen tunnels built on seagrass leaves. And you can also see the development of the flowers as well. The anemones are pretty pervasive everywhere. And then he was using transects as well, you know, to do some density studies. But you can get started very easily to identify the various species that we're looking at, and also gradually build up the amount of data that you're capturing. So I'm sure we'll find it really fascinating to hear from him and about the way that he's transforming the way that data is being shared with other groups. And I certainly think that's one of the highlights of research is their ability to share and allow us from a regional perspective, like down here in Cary, to use the data that's been submitted to do some interesting analysis of the types of habitats that we have locally. Okay, can I stop there? And are you ready to go, Alex?
Yep, I'm here.
Then just go ahead and take control.
Sure. Okay, I'll let's go. I'll just share screen. Spoilers here. We'll start from the beginning. Super. Okay. I'm Alex McMaster, and I'm a scuba diving instructor with a background in marine ecology. I'm working at the moment in Ireland on a project up in Carlingford Loch called Shifting Tides, which is just starting off at the moment. It's an arts and ecology project that's engaging people around Carlingford Loch with the water through arts and citizen science mostly. And we've just started off in the past couple of months. And it's a project that's funded under the Creative Ireland and then the Shared Island Initiative in the Department of the Taoiseach. But I'm going to be speaking this evening about a more established project, I suppose, that's been running for the past few years that I've been involved with. And it kind of had started off quite a few years ago, but I joined it really about 5 years ago while working as a scuba instructor in Greece on the Ionian island of Kefalonia, which is just off the west coast of Greece. And so our organization, COSAMAR, is the Kefalonian Organization for the Study and Awareness of the Marine Environment. And we're a group of scuba instructors who also have backgrounds in marine biology, history, and other areas. So we run a variety of different projects. I'm going to chat about the seagrass project specifically, but we also work with the Mediterranean monk seal, recording individuals and the local population in caves. So we have a couple of cave divers in our team who are installing cameras inside. It's a limestone island, so there are a lot of caves, and we're installing cameras inside of caves to record these populations. We also have an invasive species program, mostly dealing at the moment with lionfish. And then we do, because we're a really small organization, we invest quite a lot of our time into awareness raising work, which I'll come on to towards the end. But to focus on what we do with seagrass, the seagrass that you find in the Mediterranean is specifically endemic to the Mediterranean. It's a different species group, I suppose, from the Zostera species that you find around Ireland and the British Isles. And its scientific name is Posidonia oceanica, which is a fairly sort of wide-reaching sort of choice of names. I suppose you've got Poseidon in there and then the ocean. But in a similar sense to Zostera species, it performs a lot of the same functions. So if you think about it ecologically, it's a carbon sink. It's a habitat for a huge number of fish and invertebrates. It's a nursery for fish, for juvenile fish. You can very often see the little tiny fish down there inside it. And it's got really, really dense new root networks that go quite deep into the seabed. It grows extremely thick. So you can find these root networks of rhizomes that are growing up from the seabed 2 or 3 or 4 meters high before you then have the seagrass growing on top. And the seagrass itself was growing perhaps up to about a meter, 50 centimeters to a meter in length in the leaves. But then the roots can be several meters high. And these systems can grow for tens or even hundreds of thousands of years. I think the oldest seagrass meadow that's been found was off the coast of Sicily. It was 200,000 years old and 15 kilometers across, because these plants, they are flowering plants, so they're very distinctive seaweeds, and they produce a seed, well, they produce a fruit, which is known in Italy anyway as olives of the sea. And these fruits float to the surface, bob along the surface, and then whenever they rot, they release a seed which sinks back to the seabed. That seed can then start a new colony of seagrass, which expands slowly outwards. And these individual colonies are considered to be individual organisms that can be, you know, many, many kilometers across and thousands of years old. So it depends, I suppose, on where you draw the line of the individual, but that's, I think, a philosophical question we probably don't have time to get into. So the threats that are mostly facing these meadows in the Mediterranean, typically they would cover about 30% of coastal regions, and they extend from about 5 meters deep to about 40 meters deep. That range is important when it comes onto our work, because most of our work is with recreational divers, and so that kind of range of 5 to 40 meters is very much within the typical range of divers that allows us to do the work that we do. But most of the threats that face it are coming from climate change, from coastal development, where they're being directly damaged, these meadows, by dredging and by construction. In the Ionian Islands, most of the damage is actually coming from boat anchors. So in the same way that you have in really popular coral reef areas, where you have anchors dropping and causing a lot of damage, and actually the small anchors off small boats that are frequenting the same bays over and over and over again. And these images I took a few years ago, you sort of have to forgive me and the diver I'm down there with for our slight recklessness, because the diver on the left, you can see she has got her right arm extended with an SMB. So we did have an SMB with us, but that's an anchor just being dropped. And her sort of poor form is because she's absolutely sprinting away from the anchor chain as it's laid right on top of us. People often don't have a lot of recognition for SMBs. In fact, they take interest in them and come right up to them and investigate them and then drop anchors on top of them. So this is one particular bay that's significantly degraded. It's our sort of main target bay for restoration work. And as you can see, like, it's really significantly damaged. And you can actually see in the right-hand photo where you have single shoot of seagrass that's kind of just hanging on there. Just to the right of it, you can see really small green sort of shoots coming up. And those are actually an invasive algal species, which comes in to replace seagrass meadows. It doesn't threaten seagrass meadows, but for us, it's an indication of where seagrass meadows could thrive, because they inhabit the same ecological niche. So this is an interesting point that we take under consideration in our surveys. So for the past 3 years, we've been carrying out surveys in 4 different bays. We increased the capacity of our surveys by inviting students from all over Europe, and we run a scientific diving course, which takes place over 2 weeks. We run 2 sessions a year, And we have about six students on the course, mostly who have a background in marine biology of some sort, although we usually find it's far more, we get a lot more out of people whenever they actually have a strong diving background and not a strong biology background, because they're able to go down there and actually sort of manage sort of multitasking and task loading, even though it's quite a gentle level. And mostly divers who are coming from around Ireland, the UK, the Baltic, where they have, you know, generally slightly more, significantly more challenging conditions than we face in the Mediterranean, are often able to sort of carry out the surveys far more efficiently than the biology students who are coming with very little diving experience, which is interesting, I think, to note from a citizen science perspective. So we carry out surveys that look at the density and coverage of seagrass meadows. The training takes place over 1 week, but that's a whole scientific diving course. So generally, if we have an experienced diver who's coming in, the actual seagrass surveys, you can sort of brief them on pretty much, go out and do one trial run, and then it's fine. Everyone's got the hang of it. But because we're running a more in-depth scientific diving course, the students are usually there for a week. We cover a lot of bases of scientific diving, of scientific techniques underwater. And then we sort of come onto the seagrass surveys at the crux of it all. So we're carrying out surveys with transects and quadrats. So we're going down there and we're running out transects tapes, which we then send divers along in buddy pairs to measure the quantity of seagrass that's occurring underneath those transect tapes. And then we have quadrats, which are just really simple PVC squares, just made from PVC tubing with some holes drilled in them so they don't float. And we take those down, and the students are placing those over the seagrass, and they're then counting the number of shoots. It's quite a meditative task, counting the number of shoots within each quadrat. And the number of shoots then gives us an idea of the density of the seagrass meadow, and the density of the seagrass meadow gives us an idea of the health of the seagrass meadow. Now, because I mentioned that seagrasses are a habitat for a whole host of species, we also extend our surveys to looking at fish species. So this is something that's quite simple. We have our divers swimming along for periods of time. I need to remember how long the period of time is, but it's either 2 or 5 minutes. And I guess because we have quite a high frequency of fish, that we can have such a short interval there, and divers are then recording the number of different species of fish that they see within a certain distance of themselves. And then those surveys give us an indication year on year of how the fish populations are, and also how those fish populations correlate to the seagrass meadow health. Because one thing that we really push for in our work is that we're not just working as an isolated scientific organization that are researching seagrass for ourselves and for its benefit, but we really want to promote the wider benefits that seagrass meadows have. So in this case, we're recording the fish occurrence. We're actually including commercially viable fish species in those surveys so that we can kind of say these meadows have a benefit for small scale fisheries. And we have a lot of interest from small scale fishers in the area, from marine protected areas that ensure the sustainability of their own fish stocks, and also in the restriction of industrial fishing activities. So this is all something that the research then feeds into. It also feeds into the management of the marine protected area in which we're operating. And these are a couple of, this is one of our dive masters on the left and one of our students last year on the right, which you can see fairly clearly from the fact that the dive master is not in the seagrass meadow and the student is plunked right inside the seagrass. And so we carry out these surveys, and then those are fed on to the marine protected area management body. And they then feed into also our own work, which is around the installation of permanent moorings, which are to prevent those damages from anchors. So one other survey type that we run alongside our in-water surveys are these aerial surveys, which are feasible in the Ionian Sea because of the clarity of the water. So we usually get, if we're running these surveys using drones, which fly a pattern in the sky and then stitch all the images together, we end up having images where we can see approximately 15 meters deep, to the degree of accuracy that we need in which to just outline seagrass meadows. They're very clearly visible here in the dark patches in amongst the sand and the rocks. And we also use these images to communicate to boat users to say, look, even, I mean, this may be from the sky, but from the level of your boat, you can see where the meadows are and you can actively try and avoid them, because there is really a lack of awareness around the damage that anchors can have in seagrass meadows. So we also run these aerial surveys, and these have informed a new program that we're running this year, which is going to be actually testing the use of permanent moorings, which are essentially going to be attached onto the seabed and have chains running up from them with buoys along the chains to then for boats to moor on. Apologies, my phone's just ringing. I'm just going to, there we go. Another thing we do that works quite well is just running advocacy programs with tourists and boat users. These are usually a bit more sort of they're friendly, but they're slightly more on the nose than the sort of events that we run that are more aimed at the local area and people living in the local area. And these are the sort of presentations where we. Usually it's really easy to communicate because people just don't know, and it's just a matter of telling them and immediately people will pick it up and take interest. That this works really well for us. We've also started working a bit wider than seagrass meadows because, you know, while we can do research with the meadows themselves, there are a number of other creatures that I suppose are indicator species that indicate the health of the meadows, and because they rely on them directly. So this is a new program that we're running with the marine mollusk Pinna rudis, which is a pen shell. It's a bivalve, so it's essentially a mussel with spiky ends on it. These have started increasing in numbers in the past couple of years, which is really interesting because previously seagrass meadows were inhabited by the larger cousin of the Pinna rudis, which is the Pinna nobilis, which was a huge pen shell that used to we used to use as an ecological indicator species. And so we knew that by finding lots of these pen shells that we had potentially healthy seagrass meadows. Unfortunately, a few years ago, a disease wiped out most of the population of the larger Pinna nobilis, and the smaller, they're not that small, they're about 15 to 20 centimeters in size, Pinna rudis pen shells have started increasing in number. So we're monitoring that increase. And we're often finding them at the edges of the seagrass meadows, whereas we find the Pinna nobilis right in the midst of the meadows. So we're interested in what this says about the kind of edges and extents of seagrass meadows and the relation that the two have with one another. So this is something that we're sort of just starting to look into. So I guess this is mostly our scientific work, but we have started branching beyond it in the past couple of years. As I mentioned, the Shifting Tides project in Carlingford is largely an arts project. We started looking into how we can use initially visual art through photography, and then moving on to other potentially more imaginative means to communicate what can be, I suppose, easily overlooked. Seagrass meadows don't necessarily inspire many of us the way that they might inspire Ed or myself or others who are working with these meadows. So we tried to find sort of imaginative ways of doing that. We started off with underwater photography exhibitions that were put up publicly. We have one going out this year, which is specific to seagrass meadows. And I didn't find it difficult to take interesting photographs of seagrass meadows, but the folks who were sort of looking at them and telling us what they thought were nice photos had different opinions to what I had. So we've ended up with we've managed to get a collection together of seagrass meadows that aren't repetitive. I think we have a series of about 15 photographs and somehow we've got a huge degree of variety and interest between them. So we've been working with underwater photography as one method of communicating seagrass meadows and their beauty and importance. And then we started running artist residencies as well, and inviting in artists. So this is a couple of screenshots from a film I was involved with producing last year, where we had two dancers in the water, one in the seagrass meadow and one up on the land, and the two sort of meet at some point in the film, and there's beautiful music and dancing and underwater performance and free diving, and some, I think, adequate camera skill as well in there, that all fed into this aspect of the project. So we're finding that having a multiplicity of means of approaching these meadows, especially because we're an organization that doesn't necessarily have the really specific technical expertise to carry out in-depth and groundbreaking analysis of these meadows, we're finding it the best thing that we can do as a small organization with a variety of sort of rough expertise in various different areas, means that trying different ways of approaching the way we study seagrass meadows, the way we communicate them, has really sort of helped us to move forward as a small organization in ways that perhaps taking a really narrow and specific approach wouldn't have allowed us to do. And so I think that's been one of the real sort of learning points we've had in the past few years. That, and also branching out at the start and having a whole breadth of things that we've done and then narrowing down to the things that really worked. So the surveys themselves are working really well. The aerial surveys, the artist residency is not kicking off, as the scientific diving course really has. And I guess the new part for us is now the study with the mollusk, the pinnerudis. So we'll see how that goes. So that's the project. You can have a look at it in a bit more detail on our website, cosamora.org. If you have anyone that's interested, just as a little sort of pitch, we do have our scientific diving course running through May and June this year. So if anyone you know would be interested in going, we are running that. I should mention that funding wise, we started off funding the project through the dive center where we were all working. So at the start, all of us were paid out of, because we were working full time on it, we weren't working as volunteers. We were all just working as dive instructors and doing this actually on the side, kind of. Or we were using the sort of peak season of July and August to fund the work that we were doing in the sort of quieter ends of the summer and in the spring and autumn. And then over time, we managed to gather funding. So in the past 2 years, we've been funded by the Paddy Aware Foundation. We got a community grant to start off with, which was €10,000 for our first year. And then they've sort of provided us with more sustainable funding since then, to so that we can have two people working full time for 5 months of the year, and then a couple of auxiliary staff, and then of course the costs that are associated with running boats and dive equipment and everything else, insurance and the building, etc. So that's kind of where we've come from there. So check it out. Have a look at Shifting Tides as well. Can't remember the name of the website, but if you look up the Shifting Tides Project Carlingford Loch on Google, you'll find it. And we're going to be running a whole bunch of things in the coming weeks and months. We're running over this year and next year. This Sunday, we have Dave Wall up in Greencastle running a beach biodiversity survey workshop. And I'll be there. So
I think we've just lost you, Alex. Brilliant. So that's excellent. Thank you so much for a great presentation, Alex. If you'd like to, you could take a couple of minutes and just put links to both of those into the chat. Yeah. If anybody would like to take those while we take a look at a video from Grace Carr, if that's okay with everybody. But I'm sure there'll be lots of questions for you in just a minute. You can wait a few. Grace Carr, let's see, am I sharing at this point? Is the Irish Wildlife Trust Marine Advocacy Officer. She's been promoting the natural restoration law for a long time, and this was her clip that you filmed today, recognizing the fact that the bill just passed. So here we go for a short
Hiya. Few minutes. Chris here with the Irish Wildlife Trust. So I'm the Marine Advocacy Officer with the Irish Wildlife Trust. And Irish Wildlife Trust is a non-governmental organisation, and our aim is to help protect and restore Ireland's nature and biodiversity. And we also want to empower and encourage other people to do the same through education and outreach. So we've been working on the EU Nature Restoration Law. You might have heard a bit about it over the past couple of years. It was quite a complicated file and quite a contentious file in some ways. But I'm going to give you a quick sort of overview on it, some of the targets within it, and what's happened so far. So it was first proposed by the European Commission back in 2022, and it was proposed to restore 20% of EU land and 20% of EU sea. So this law is really, really vitally needed because over 81% of EU habitats are in bad ecological condition and they're declining. So it's probably one of the most important pieces of environmental legislation to come out in the last 30 years since the EU Birds and Habitats Directive came out. So last year was a really big year for the Nature Restoration Law. There was a lot of misinformation spread about the campaign. There was a lot of political groups in the EU that wanted to see this law killed and dead in the water. So misinformation was spread and this scared a lot of people. And it's not surprising because they were saying things like, you know, landowners and farmers are going to be forced to give up their land for restoration measures. While this isn't true, in the actual text, it says that any private landowners or farmers, if they want to give up their land for restoration, it will be completely voluntary. And member states also have to make this attractive for them. So through funding and ensuring that there's a just transition for anyone that decides to do this. But of course, if you're hearing big political parties saying that, you know, your land's going to be taken away from you, etc., it's extremely scary for people to hear. So last year, a lot of our time was spent trying to counteract these claims, these misinformation claims, and talk about what the law actually entails. So it managed to get through different votes last year. The Irish government supported the law. It didn't initially, but then the Irish government was then supportive of it, which was great to see. And all Irish MEPs voted to support the law last year as well. So it managed to get through to trilogue negotiations, which is where the European Council, which Ireland is a part of, there's representatives from each member state within the council. So the European Council, the European Parliament, where the MEPs are, and the European Commission all negotiated the text. And they came up with a final text last November. So it was a compromise on both sides, from the people who didn't want the law, people who wanted it weakened, people who wanted a strong and ambitious law. So compromises from everyone. And while it's not as strong as we might like, or it was as the initial law, it's still a really, really good text and a great step forward in nature restoration. So this final text was decided in November, and then the final vote was yesterday on the law. And of course, there was a last minute campaign to try and kill the law again. So I've been very busy over the last few weeks trying to make sure that we've got the law over the line. And I'm really happy to say that it did get over the line. So it was approved yesterday in the European Parliament. So it was a really, really good day for nature and for marine conservation. So I won't go into too much detail about the land targets or anything like that, but I'll talk about some of the marine ones. So for 20% of EU sea to be restored, priority is going to be given to Natura 2000 sites, so the protected areas we already have, which are designated under the EU Birds and Habitats Directive. So SSEs, Special Areas of Conservation, and SPAs, Special Protection Areas. So they're going to be prioritised, which is really good news because, as you probably know, Ireland doesn't have the best track record when it comes to managing our protected areas. Ireland was even taken to the European Court of Justice over not having site-specific management plans in place for their protected areas. But it's gotten to the stage now where protecting isn't enough anymore. We have to actually restore these degraded habitats. So any of the habitats that were listed under the Habitats Directive are included. So this includes seagrass as well. So for any sort of coastal areas, seagrass that are within protected areas, those are going to be prioritised to be restored by 2030, which is brilliant news, and it's going to force the Irish government to do better when it comes to managing our protected areas. And then after 2030, other areas are then also going to be included within the target. But first off, Natura 2000 sites are being prioritized. It's not just coastal areas either. There are some provisions for fisheries as well within the law, which is very exciting. So there's an article which basically has makes it better coherence with the common fisheries policy. So for example, if there's an area in Irish waters that we believe should be a protected area, but other EU member states have got fishing interests in that area, up until now, it generally just kind of gets forgotten about and its business as usual carries on. But the Nature Restoration Law actually insists that the common fisheries policy is adhered to. So that means that there's actual timelines put in place for member states to put in joint recommendations that have the conservation objectives for an area. So if the member state doesn't submit these joint recommendations, then the commission has to step in and do that. So if Ireland has an area that they believe should be protected, but they don't submit the joint recommendations and business as usual carries on with other EU vessels fishing within it, the commission must step in and put in these conservation objectives. So it's really exciting that this got through. This is one of the main things that we were sort of pushing for in our advocacy. And it's going to make a really big difference when it comes to our new marine protected area legislation, which is coming through the Dáil at the minute. It's going to really help with ensuring that we get really strong management measures in place for protected areas. So I will leave it there. I talked a bit longer than I meant to, but if anyone has any questions further on the law, then do be free to contact me through the Irish Wildlife Trust socials or through the website. You can find our emails, because I'm happy to go through any further details on the law. Okay, thank you. Bye.
Okay, so that was great, Carr. Yeah, some great news, especially for Seagrass, for sure. Rory, you want to move to Q&A at this point?
Yeah,